They claim the soul Bible has outlived its day, that there are some changes that need to be made. Let no man deceive.
Take your Bibles or change. Turn with me to Matthew 24.
Truth is determined by the test of time. Trust the old Bible with its these and that's. Never mind those people who won't throw it out. Churches are drifting and falling away. We need this old book more than ever today.
Welcome to Happy Cross Ministries Wednesday Bible Study. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. I will read the entire passage, and then we will go back and look at each verse, break it down, and bring it to life, and expose the meaning. The name of the program is King James Version Exposed. Because we use the King James Version, we look at the verses, break them down, bring them to life, and expose the meaning. I'm Brother David, and let's get started here. Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, beginning at verse 1. Once again, I'm reading from the King James Version. And it came to pass that, as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the Lake of Gennesaret, and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little farther from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, Launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answering said unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night, and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, so that they began to sink. So when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he was astonished at all that were with him, and at the draught of the fishes which they had taken. And so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. And Jesus said unto Simon, Fear not, from henceforth thou shalt catch men. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. Give this lesson a little bit of context here. Our passage is part of the third of six major sections of Luke's Gospel. These six sections are 1. Jesus' human relationships, 2. Jesus' baptism and testing, the third part, Jesus' ministry in Galilee, the fourth part, Jesus' journey to Jerusalem, the fifth part, Jesus' rejection and sacrifice, and the sixth part, Jesus' resurrection and ascension. The third section covers Jesus' time spent teaching, preaching, and performing miracles. Matthew chapter 4, verses 18 through 22, and Mark chapter 1, verses 16 through 20 are parallel accounts. I need to get my desk a little organized here. And we're going to go back and we'll look at the verses one by one and break them down. Verse 1, shallow water teaching. This is verse 1, once again, the press of the crowd. Verse 1, and it came to pass that, as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, He stood by the lake of Gennesaret. In Luke chapter 4, we see Jesus teaching and preaching in synagogues. Now we see him ministering out in the open for the first time in this gospel. The lake of Gennesaret was named for the fertile region on the northwest side of the lake. Compare this with Matthew chapter 14, verse 34, and Mark chapter 6, verse 53. The word Gennesaret means garden of riches. The authors of the other Gospels refer to this freshwater body as the Sea of Galilee. Look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 18, and Mark chapter 1, verse 16, and the Gospel of John chapter 6, verse 1. And John also calls it the Sea of Tiberias. We see that in the Gospel of John chapter 6, verse 1, and again in the same book, chapter 21, verse 1. In the Old Testament, it is known as the Sea of Chinnereth. We see that in Joshua chapter 12, verse 3. At 13 miles long and 7 miles wide, this picturesque lake served as the backdrop for much of Jesus' ministry. Jesus had just healed many people at Capernaum. Look at Luke chapter 4, verses 31 through 41. Located on the northwest shore of the lake, reports about Jesus and his amazing deeds went out into every place of the country round about. We see that in chapter 4, verse 37. The result was that the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God. Compare this with chapter 4, verse 42. The phrase of the word of God could mean either the word that comes from God or the word that tells of God. Either way, this marked Jesus' ministry as prophetic for Jews steeped in the Old Testament. Compare this with 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 22, and 1 Chronicles chapter 17, verse 3. What do you think? What do you think? What plan can you create to identify and eliminate distractions that work against your hearing the Word of God? Would it help to categorize these distractions in terms of from the world? Look, for example, at 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, and from within oneself. For example, look at James chapter 1, verse 14. We now come to verse 2, solution of the ship. And saw two ships standing by the lakes, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. The 1986 discovery of the Kinneret boat, dated to the 1st or 2nd century AD, offers insight into what these two ships may have looked like. Constructed mostly of cedar and oak, the boat measures about 27 feet long, 7 feet wide, and 4 feet deep. It could have supported about a ton of weight, either about 15 passengers were 5 crew members and their catch of fish. Luke chapter 8, verse 22 may indicate at least 13 people in a boat. Fishermen of the era used a large dragnet, which required 2 or more men to deploy, or it's a smaller and circular casting net. After returning from fishing, they needed to wash and stretch their nets to prepare them for the next outing. Now we come to the first part of verse 3. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. This was not the first time Simon and Jesus had met. Look at Luke chapter 4, verses 31 through 38. At Simon's home, Jesus had healed Simon's mother-in-law from a great fever, and many others were brought there with illnesses and demonization. See also the description of a previous meeting with Simon in John chapter 1, verses 40 through 42. The second part of verse 3 reads, and he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Boarding the ship solved the problem of the crowds pressing on Jesus, allowing him to still be seen and heard. Then Jesus sat down, the normal position for teaching. Look at Luke chapter 4, verses 20 through 21. This was not be the only time that Jesus taught from a boat. Look at Mark chapter 3, verse 9, and Mark chapter 4, verse 1. Now we come to the second portion of our scriptures, verses 4 through 7, which is a deep water miracle. Verses 4 and 5, the reluctant expert. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, "Launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught." And Simon, answering, said unto him, "Master, we have toiled all the night, and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word, I will let down the net." Although Jesus addressed Simon in the first of these two verses, the instructions Jesus gave included Simon's partners. The word translated, "let down," is plural in the original language. Jesus' directions would have seemed absurd to a professional fisherman. Simon and his partners had toiled all the night without catching anything, but Simon had already witnessed the power of Jesus in miracles and teaching. Those undoubtedly stood behind Simon's addressing Jesus as Master, an acknowledgement of his authority to direct Simon. And so the expert fisherman yielded to the word of the carpenter. This is foundational to Simon's future faithfulness in leadership, where he is known as Peter. Now we come to verse 6, bursting the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. Despite the apparent foolishness of casting nets after having toiled all the night and catching nothing, a great multitude of fishes was caught. If Simon and his fellow fishermen followed conventional wisdom instead of Jesus, they would not have experienced this miraculous catch. Jesus did not tell the man to cast their net in order to catch a paltry or even ordinary haul of fish. The abundance was such that their net break. This is also the case in the lives of believers today. Though the blessings we will experience because of our faithfulness are not always obvious or even what we desire to give at a given time, our God is a God who delights in giving generously to his people. His giving is not only in terms of quantity, but also of quality. Look at Matthew chapter 7, verses 7 through 11, John chapter 2, verse 10, James chapter 1, verses 17 and 18. The haul of fish in our text won't be the last one that obedience resulted. It won't be the last one that obedience resulted in. Obedience before knowledge. Now, never mind about that. Verse 7, sinking ships. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both the ships, so that they began to sink. Simon's partners in the other ship were James and John. The blessing of the fish was so overwhelming that both the ships together were barely able to handle the catch. This further emphasizes the nature of the miracle that the verse 6 describes. What do you think? In what ways can you help your church see evangelism as best achieved through partnerships rather than by lone rangers? What cultural lone ranger mores might you have overcome personally in the process? We now come to the third part of our scripture, Simon's Epiphany, a sinner's confession, verse 8. When Simon Peter saw it, all four Gospels mention that Jesus gave Simon the name Peter. Look at Matthew 16, verse 18, Mark 3, 16, Luke 6, 14, and John 1, 42, which had Cephas. The Gospel writers referred to him as Simon Peter a total of 17 times, but 15 of these are in the Gospel of John. The text before us is the only such occurrence in Luke's writing of the books of Luke and Acts. This is important in studies of the Gospel because this man goes by the name Simon Peter and Simon Peter. The reference is to one and the same person. Now we come to the second part of verse 8. He fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." Following the miraculous catch of fish and the breaking nets and sinking boats that result, we come to the third focus of Luke's narrative. Simon Peter's response in word and behavior was rightly characterized by awe and respect. Luke uses the word translated sinful man more than the other three gospel writers combined. Luke's strong tendency is to use this word in a compassionate way in referring to the targets of God's grace. Realizing himself to be in the presence of a man of God led Simon to the confession we see here. Another "what do you think" question. What do you think? What kind of crisis would have to happen for you to react to Jesus as Simon Peter did? Did you answer that question more in terms of a crisis of unexpected blessing, Peter's situation, or in terms of an unexpected loss or potential loss? For example, look at Matthew chapter 9, verse 18. Why might this distinction be important? This scene reminds us of similar ones in the Old Testament. The call of the prophet Isaiah provides one example. Isaiah chapter 6, verse 5, compare Genesis chapter 18, verse 27, and Exodus 3, verses 4 through 6. We should point out that Simon Peter's recognition of Jesus as the man of God isn't necessarily bound up in his address of Jesus as Lord at this point. The word being translated that way is often just a polite term of respect, sometimes translated as sir. Look at John chapter 4, verse 19, and John chapter 20, verse 15. Perhaps a more fitting comparison, given Simon Peter's limited awareness of Jesus' full identity at the time, are the actions of Joseph's brothers when they met him in Egypt. They bowed before Joseph, knowing that he had the power to approve or deny their aid request, but they did not know his true identity. Even so, they did not prevent them from recognizing his authority. Now we come to verses 9 and the first part of 10. The fisherman's astonishment. For he was astonished, and all that were with him, and the draught of the fishes which they had taken, and so was also James and John, the sons of Zebedee, which were partners with Simon. James and John, the sons of Zebedee, Simon's business partners, are mentioned by name for the first time in Luke's gospel. Jesus would soon choose all three men to be counted among the 12 apostles. But for now, the focus is on Simon Peter, as these others are mentioned only in passing. Now we come to Jesus' call. The second part of verse 10. Fear not. And Jesus said, the second part of verse 10. And Jesus said unto Simon, fear not. Though Jesus addressed Simon directly, it seems safe to assume that James and John could hear the comforting fear not. This phrase previously was spoken in Luke's gospel in context of angelic visitations to Zacharias, Mary, and the shepherds. This suggests that Jesus' presence was similarly disturbing, perhaps even terrifying. We now come to the third part of verse 10. Fish for men. From henceforth, thou shalt catch men. Jesus' words from henceforth reveal that this moment was a turning point. A dramatic break with the past is at hand, and Jesus' announcement of Simon's career shift was a masterful play on words and concepts. Unlike fish, which are killed when caught, the individual Simon Peter would catch would be brought from death to life. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 through 6. Jesus turned a normally deadly activity into an analogy of something precious and life-giving. He was doing nothing less than calling Simon to participate in Jesus' mission of gathering people into the kingdom of God. Rather than using tools like boats and nets, the fishermen would be empowered by the Spirit. Look at Acts chapter 1, verse 8, Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. Another what do you think question. What can you do to help your church evaluate and improve the effectiveness of its evangelistic methods? How would your word of prayer for the Lord's help in this regard? Now we come to forsake all and follow, verse 11. And when they had brought their ships to land, they forsook all and followed him. When comparing Simon's call in the four Gospels, various details make it a challenge to piece together exactly when and how Jesus called him. Matthew chapter 4, verses 18 through 22, and Mark chapter 1, verses 16 through 20, record Simon's calling. These accounts are briefer and include the call of Andrew, who was Simon Peter's brother. John chapter 1, verses 40 through 42, record Simon's calling as a result of Andrew's meeting Jesus before Simon Peter did. So the call and response may have involved multiple steps, with Luke recording the culminating event. Simon and others leaving their fishing vocation to follow Jesus permanently. The word they indicates that James and John took Jesus' words of calling, Simon to include them as well. So the three men left their ships, the nets, and the equipment, as well as the greatest catch of fish they had seen in all their lives, to follow Jesus. With one minor exception, this was the last day for 3 years that Simon, James, and John would spend as fishermen. In addition to the obvious economic ramifications, forsaking everything brought fundamental social consequences to the men. Their daily routine and their sense of identity would be forever changed. The three had entered into relationship with Jesus, thereby becoming key figures and the community beginning to form around him. Need to stop here and get a drink. Another what do you think question. What life changes have you made and will you make to forsake all and following Jesus? Categorize your response in terms of thoughts, behaviors, and speech patterns. It is interesting to fast forward the story by about 3 years to the days following Jesus' resurrection. Having three times denied knowing Jesus during Jesus' trial, Simon Peter's calling as a servant leader needed to be restored. Once again, Simon and his companions fished all night without catching a single fish. Once again, Jesus gave instructions to cast their net, and once again, they immediately caught an incredible number of fish. Then three times, Jesus told Simon Peter to feed Jesus' sheep, culminating with the simple command, "Follow me." An essential purpose of today's lesson passage is to convey to Luke's audience the proper response to Jesus and his call to ministry. Simon Peter's confession of his sinfulness, followed by the three fishermen's forsaking all to follow Jesus, stands in sharp contrast to what we see in the surrounding narratives. The people of Nazareth rejected Jesus, even trying to throw him off a cliff. Amazed by Jesus' authority to teach and perform miracles, the people of Capernaum demonstrated the opposite extreme, begging Jesus not to leave them. But see a contrast in Matthew chapter 11, verse 23. In Luke 5, we continue to see both extremes. The common people swarm on Jesus in order to be healed of their afflictions, but the religious elite who came brought skepticism and opposition. And in conclusion, what's my line? When I was a child, I enjoyed a game show called What's My Line? Each week, a panel of celebrities tried to guess the contestants' line of work by asking only yes or no to questions. Any Christian who appeared on the show really should have been regarded as a trick contestant, regardless of that person's workaday occupation. He or she also had work to do for Jesus. Do you realize that you also have another line of work? Everyone who responds to Jesus' call to follow him shares a common job title and description. Look at Matthew chapter 28, verses 19 and 20. The way in which we live out that calling varies greatly, but the key component is that we further God's plan of extending his kingdom, which is based and built on the good news of his son, Jesus. Simon Peter, James, and John did indeed pull up stakes to travel with Jesus. The fact may serve as an example. Call to follow today as Christians relocate to the other side of the globe as missionaries. But strong argument can be made that although Luke chapter 5, verses 1 through 11, depicts the fisherman's call to full-time vocational ministry, that text does not thereby serve as a directive that all followers of Jesus must do exactly likewise. Think of the man who wanted to go with Jesus after Jesus delivered him from demonization. Jesus told him to return home and share with the people there what God had done for him. Jesus used the disciples' occupation as fishermen as an analogy of what he was calling them to do in ministry for him. How could you do likewise regarding your job? For example, if you are a farmer, what would it look like for you to be a farmer of people? Whether your calling is to full-time vocational ministry or to Christian witness in the secular workplace or to serve your family as a homemaker, how can you state your calling as a purpose statement for your life in Christ's kingdom? Let's close out with a short prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the privilege of responding to your Son's call. Help us to fulfill our calls to fish for people. In the Son's name we pray, amen. And we'll close out here with a thought to remember and a song. Followers of Jesus, fish for people, start fishing. And we're going to close out with a song here as soon as I get it pulled up.
Peter, John, and James could never be the same after they heard him say, I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me. I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me. I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise. Follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Cast your nets aside and join the battle tide. He will be your guide.
tried to make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men. Jesus bore the cross together in the lost. Oh, what a mighty cost to set us free from sin.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.
He said,
rise and follow me, I'll make you worthy. Rise and follow me, I'll make you fishers of men.